Moltes gràcies. Anem, com que hem volgut posar tants continguts, això ara va una mica apretat. Moltes gràcies, és un plaer per mi introduir el professor James Fraser. Ell és catedràtic d'Història i d'Educació de la Universitat de Nova York i la seva característica és que té tres elements que normalment no es donen en una mateixa persona. L'un és l'acadèmic. Ell és historiador de l'educació, ha estat president de la Societat d'Història de l'Educació i ha treballat molt intensament sobre no només la història de l'educació, sinó sobre el procés i l'evolució en la formació de mestres als Estats Units. Una segona característica, en la banda aquesta d'acadèmic, ell té un altre element, va ser el fundador, el primer degà de la Northeastern University a Boston, on va crear la facultat, just després de la segona característica, que crec que és rellevant, que és que va ser el líder de la Task Force que va reformar la formació de mestres a l'estat de Massachusetts en el model que apuntarà després. La tercera característica és que ell ha estat vicepresident, ara senior advisor, d'una de les fundacions més importants sobre educació, que és la Woodrow Wilson Foundation, dins la qual ell va promoure una fellowship molt important de suport als mestres. Aquesta combinació, un acadèmic que ha treballat en la reforma de les polítiques públiques en la formació de mestres, en els estàndards a l'estat de Massachusetts, ha presidit la conferència de degans a Massachusetts, en aquest moment està a Nova York, continua participant en aquesta fundació. De fet, aquest novembre va presentar a aquesta fundació un document en què parla de la importància de la residència, és a dir, del model similar al dels metges per la formació de mestres i que a la vegada en aquest moment està innovant a la Universitat de Nova York en la formació de mestres, introduint això en un màster, crec que dona un perfil radicalment diferent. So, let me just turn into why is Jim here. Yesterday we had the first session that we were speaking about Finland and the case of schools, and then today we moved trying to learn the university experience in Finland as well. Sometimes when we do that, we get a little bit skeptical and we think, well, this is Finland, this is the East Coast, and we are here and our reality is so different. The fact though is that Finland 50 years ago had the possibility to change these things. Massachusetts 30 years ago had the possibility to change it, and we do have the possibility as well. So on Jim's remarks, I think that it's important to highlight at least four things. The first, the fact that clinical experience, residency, clinical experience is what we call residencia, gives sense to theory, and that people don't teach the way they are explained how to teach, but people teach the way they have been taught if they don't have a different experience. The second idea is that teachers should have an intellectual base. If they don't have some kind of base and they don't have activated this desire for learning, what we call lifelong learning, it's impossible to create this desire for learning in the learning experience in the school. This is very similar to what the beginnings of the Autonomous University of Barcelona was thinking when they said we need, when Pilar Benajam said primary school teachers, secondary school teachers, they both need to know something before being able to teach something. The third idea is related with this. With the same element. We are based in a traditional assumption that schools transmit knowledge. And I'm saying this because when you see our model of education, which is something that happened in many countries, we make the idea that content is what matters, and that is why teachers of younger kids are less trained and less paid. So in our model, we assume that the more content you are able to transmit, the more training you need, and the more important your work is. Now, we do know today that this is false, but our structure is still based on the same assumption. And I think that this is something that Jim's also trying to fight with. The last element is that the centralized model of control based on distrust is not useful to promote excellence. Jim, yesterday in the US consulate, we were having a breakfast on that, and he said, with government policies, you could try to avoid that bad things happen, but you are not going to promote excellence if you don't create trust. Now, let me link this with something that Secretary Castellà said before. We are in a process that Catalonia has good chances to become a European state. Both in this possibility and without it, we have the duty to think what in our system is alien and what in our system could be in the way that we want. When we talk about our education system, we know that we have a system from elementary school to university that is based on the idea that every school is the same, every university is the same, every teacher is the same, every university professor is the same. This is based on the traditional model of civil servants, oppositions, the way you filter the entrance, the way you develop professionally people. Now, we do know that the system that we have today in our public education system is not the traditional system that we used to have. We had local councils creating schools like the Escola del Mar or Escola del Bosc, which was a Sunset, and Pere Pagès. They appointed directors and they hired teachers that were not civil servants. And that worked. We have in the Mancomunitat a different model of training teachers that it worked. In the Republic, we created an autonomous university that hired teachers instead of having civil servants, that it worked. So somehow, I would say both the previous talk and Fraser's one should invite us to think disruptively on what we could do as a country if we really think that education is important. And with this, I give you the floor, Jim. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Edward. I'm really honored to be here. It is terrific to be invited. Valerie and I started these conversations in New York, and to be invited back here to Barcelona and continue this conversation with all of you is just an extraordinary opportunity for a New Yorker who has never been to Barcelona before. So it's lovely to be here. I want to say a special thank you to the people who are doing the simultaneous translation. It's wonderful to be able to have this conversation back and forth between our various languages. And when Eduardo invited me, I said, well, I really apologize, I don't speak Spanish. And he said, that's all right, the conference will be in Catalan. So I'm especially grateful for the translation. I'm also grateful for Professor Levonen in the last conversation. I think I want to take that last slide home with me in my suitcase. It's the something, I may have some questions about parts of it, but I think it's a model that all of us can use in different places. But my assignment today is to talk a bit about teacher education in the United States in 2015, the role of universities, of the critics of universities, and the competition that is growing from non-university providers. And I hope this is useful as you are rethinking the structure of Catalan teacher preparation. I don't come with any formula or answers, but hopefully we can take a dialogue. I've certainly already learned lessons I want to take home to New York and the United States, and I hope this can be an exchange of ideas. This is also not an easy assignment. Teacher education in the United States today is in enormous turmoil. Overall, I think it's a healthy turmoil, and I think it's going to be better as a result. But we are in an era of extraordinary change. Programs are changing. Some providers of teacher preparation are growing. Others are shrinking. State, federal, independent accreditation rules are changing and changing very fast. So as I walk through this picture, if at times you feel confused by my remarks, you understand them perfectly. I want to divide my remarks this morning into sort of three sections. I will start with a bit of an overview of where we are in teacher education in the United States, and particularly in New York City, where I live at the moment. I then want to frame these remarks historically, how we got here. I am, after all, a historian. I have to frame everything historically. And finally, I want to briefly make some suggestions about where we perhaps are going and might go in teacher preparation in the United States. And then during our discussion time, I hope we can have a back and forth about whether those same directions are useful in Catalonia or different directions are more useful. So taking a look at where we are today, it's an interesting moment, as I said, in teacher preparation. As recently as 1990, if a person wanted to become a public school teacher in most parts of the United States, she or he basically assumed that they needed to go to a university-based teacher preparation program, a school or department of education in either a public or private university that was licensed by their state to prepare teachers. And the route through the university was the route to the teaching career. Today, less than two decades later, there are a very wide varieties of routes into teaching. There are routes to university-based programs that are pretty much the same as they were in the late 1980s and early 1990s. There is a choice of other teacher preparation programs that have radically rethought their structures and created radically new models, much more time in schools, much less time in classrooms, in university classrooms, than was the case in most university programs 20 years ago. And then there are the options of the extraordinary range of alternative providers, most of which are offering teacher preparation outside of universities altogether. Few people can keep track of all of this range of resources, and few people understand what is the best option for an aspiring teacher. Indeed, both the university programs and the alternative providers have a great variety of approaches to teacher preparation, very coherent arguments for why their approach is the best and every other approach is second rate, and many arguments going on, very intense arguments in the discussions at national meetings about teacher preparation. But the reality is that all of us who are concerned with teacher preparation live in a very different world than we did 20 years ago. As I said, 20 years ago, if you wanted to be a teacher, you went to a university program. This fall, 40% of the new teachers hired in public schools around the United States came from alternative providers to teacher preparation. That's an extraordinary change, and it's a reminder to those of us who work in universities that our ownership of teacher preparation is something that can be strong and can also slip away very quickly. Maybe for good, maybe for ill. In the midst of these debates about teacher preparation, most providers will argue that they are doing the best. And yet for teacher preparation faculty, for state agencies, for school leaders who hire teachers, for people who come to international conferences, there's always this difficulty of making sense of what is teacher preparation in the United States. One word of clarification I want to make about my remarks. I don't know a lot about Catalonia. I know that in many parts of Europe, the preparation of primary or elementary teachers, childhood teachers, can be very different from the preparation of secondary teachers. In terms of structure, this is not true in the United States. Since the 1930s, teacher preparation for both younger children and secondary students has followed the same structure. We'll have different courses, you'll do your student teaching in a school of the age level you're preparing for, but the overall structure, the expectation for degrees is the same at both levels. The other thing to remember about the United States is that the national government, the federal government, has far less authority than in most European countries. It's gained authority in the last two administrations, but it still is a minor player. Teacher preparation rules are set primarily at the state level, and with 50 states, we have 50 different sets of rules. And private agencies play a very large role, whether it's private philanthropy, such as the Gates Foundation, that has very strong opinions and makes their opinions known and gives funding to people who agree with them, or the very fact that colleges and universities are accredited by private associations made up of colleges and universities that control the structure and what's acceptable in all of university life, but particularly in teacher preparation. So let's look at this this challenge that teacher education faces today. On October 20th, 2013, New York Times columnist Bill Killer published a piece called An Industry of Mediocrity. It didn't take the reader long to understand what industry he had in question. Keeler had borrowed the title of his article from a recent study of teacher education done by the National Council of Teacher Quality, and the Keeler article and the National Council of Teacher Quality report were only two in a very long chain of reports, commentaries, et cetera, to make promote a common opinion. In the opinion of them and of many Americans, educators, policy leaders, average citizens, teacher education in the United States is in a crisis. It's more than a crisis from the perspective of saying an industry of mediocrity. It is at this moment seen as a disaster and responsible for the poor rankings. If Finland has terrific rankings in PISA, we don't have rankings we're very happy about in PISA. And so the question is always, why is that happening? And it's easy in that context, of course, to blame the teacher education programs, to point a finger at the university programs and say they need to do better, and certainly they do need to do better. I think teacher education, as I said, is in a kind of crisis. I also think all of universities' education is in a kind of crisis today. And there is major discussion going on about what's the value of a college degree, what's the importance of university research, which is essential to faculty promotion but may or may not be part of what the future holds, what's useful to the future. And I think universities are just beginning the process that teacher education has been through for some time of really radically rethinking their work and their role in the larger society. And I think that's going to be a very important process and one very interesting to watch. From my own perspective, though, as a faculty member in a school of education in a university-based program, a former dean of a different one, education schools are still in the forefront of my mind, and we know that we are in for a lot of criticism, a lot of critique, a lot of restructuring. The alternative providers, the growing cadre of alternative providers, are also in for their own critique and rethinking. Just a week ago, the New York Times also carried an article, quote, "Fewer top graduates want to join Teach for America." Teach for America is probably the most popular teacher preparation program in the United States, and it's growing in many parts of Europe, including Catalonia. The article went on to say, well, the rebound in the American economy is offering more opportunities. Maybe people don't want to go to teaching at all the way they did. But perhaps also some of the critique of Teach for America that has emerged from some of the university providers has led some students to rethink it. What we need to be careful about when we talk about critique of either university-based programs or alternative providers is to remember, who are we critiquing? Who are we looking at? So if we look for a moment at the growing number of alternative to university providers in teacher education in the United States, Teach for America is certainly, quote, the granddaddy of alternative providers. It's the best known. It's the one people talk about a lot. Teach for America recruits top flight college students, offers them a free summer preparation program in return for a promise to go where they are needed and teach in public schools, often in some of the poorest areas in the United States, urban areas in Detroit, in Washington, D.C., rural Mississippi and Alabama. And they recruit some of the most able college students in the United States. No question, they have raised the bar in terms of the quality of people entering the teaching profession. What is The last statistic I heard was that a quarter of the graduating class of Yale University applied for Teach for America this year. That's extraordinary, and it's not unique to Yale. It's happening all around the country, including at New York University, where I teach. In addition to Teach for America, many charter schools have started their own teacher preparation program. Many school districts and superintendents have started their own teacher preparation programs based in school districts. There is a, quote, teacher residency model that began with the Boston teacher residency is now spread to Chicago, to Philadelphia, most recently to Seattle, Washington, where an independent organization creates a year-long residency program, perhaps loosely affiliated with a university, but only very loosely affiliated, so that the core of teacher preparation is happening really outside of a university and in classrooms. And then for-profit, we do have for-profit universities in the United States, for-profit universities like the University of Phoenix have launched online teacher preparation programs where you can do it through distance learning. So with that range, any generalization about alternative providers, just like any generalization about university providers, is probably going to be wrong much of the time, because we need to say which university or which alternative providers. What we do know is that the critique of alternative providers is fairly new, because the growth of alternative providers is fairly new. The critique of university-based programs has been around for a long time, and it's certainly the reason that alternative providers grew up. Back in 1953, Arthur Bester published a book called Educational Wastelands, The Retreat from Learning in Our Public Schools. Guess who Bester blamed for the retreat from learning in our public schools? It was, of course, the university-based teacher preparation programs. And he said, instead of taking the opportunity to create a new and genuinely professional approach to education, the schools engaged in a mere upgrading and renumbering of old courses in pedagogical method. Most students were apt to pile these courses layers thick upon an undergraduate major in pedagogy. Bester blamed the education faculty for creating an unholy alliance with state agencies that protected them from the rest of the university. A decade later, James Kerner and former Harvard president James Bryant Conant developed a similar critique, though Conant added to his critique the fact that he felt that the arts and science faculty spent far too little time worrying about teacher preparation. And that critique has gone on to the present day. What's interesting to ask is, where did these university schools of education come from? In Finland, you had this extraordinary opportunity to fundamentally rethink everything about your society and your education after the Second World War. In Catalonia, you're in the process now. In the United States, teacher preparation did not always reside in universities, and most of my colleagues forget that. Up until about the 1830s in the United States, the basic assumption was that any smart person could teach. If you'd been to school, why couldn't you teach school? And so lots of people were hired for teachers, and they taught for a short amount of time and moved on. In the 1830s, what was called the era of the common school reformation in education, a number of changes took place. The school year was lengthened. Compulsory schooling was instituted, and more students started going to school for longer periods of time. And the same reformers also created what they called normal schools, separate schools for the preparation of teachers, initially at the high school level, sort of then moving on to a secondary level. They created summer teacher institutes for people who couldn't attend normal school. They created what was called the normal program in high schools. And the majority of American teachers in the 19th century actually went to normal programs in secondary schools and then became elementary school teachers as a result. It was only in the 20th century that this began to change, and then it began to change very rapidly. The Great Depression of the 1930s allowed school districts to be much more selective than they ever had been before. There were many unemployed people, and they could choose who they wanted to have be teachers, and so the standards went up. And after the Second World War in the United States, there was much more emphasis on the growth of universities, and teacher preparation moved from independent, it's interesting, in 1945, at the end of the Second World War, most teachers were still being prepared in independent, normal schools, sometimes now called state teachers' colleges. By 1960, nearly all teacher preparation had moved into universities. As Elizabeth Green, in a recent very popular book called Building a Better Teacher, said, the subject of education had to be offered in universities. Economics demanded it. By 1948, there were 1 million teachers in the United States, and for universities, the calculation was clear. Training teachers made financial sense, whether there was something for them to do or not. And so education moved into universities. I will argue that it moved into universities from independent normal schools without as much thought as there should have been about how they would fit together. And it was that very change in structure that created some of the complaint that still exists today, that future teachers spend too much time in methods courses learning how to teach, too little time either in the content, disciplinary content, or in schools learning actual practice. And so in the normal schools, and I don't want to romanticize the normal schools, I think they had their own problems, but in the normal schools, a professor of history in my field would be a professor of history and a professor of history methods, or a professor of mathematics would teach mathematics and how to teach mathematics. As teacher education moved into the university, there already was a history department and a math department, and so the education faculty became an independent faculty teaching the how, the methods of instruction, while somebody else in another department taught the content of what to teach. I need to learn more about how this works in Finland, but in the United States, what it created was a kind of assumption that the student would do shuttle diplomacy between the arts and science faculty and the methods faculty, and you know, God forbid that the two professors should ever talk to each other. The student had to be the connection. At the same time, if the education department, given the nature of universities, the education department was going to grow, it had to capture as many credits as possible. Every time a student took a methods course, the department got more money, there was a chance to hire more faculty. Every time they took a content course, that money was lost. And so the tension was not just thinking about what's the best way to prepare teachers, but what is the structure that's going to give me academic strength. The same pressures responded about how much time to spend in schools. So the old normal schools had what you described in Finland, that their own lab schools, their own schools that were closely affiliated with them, where people were the faculty of both. Most major universities didn't want to have such schools, and so they closed those schools, developed partnerships with nearby school systems, and hired clinical faculty who were of a much lower status to supervise the people working in those schools. And again, the student was to do the shuttle diplomacy between the methods courses and what went on. If what I'm describing is kind of less than first-rate system, you at least have Fraser's understanding of a lot of what created the context for some of the problems we face in teacher preparation today. In the 1980s, a whole major reform effort took place in teacher preparation. There was a group called the Holmes Group of Education Deans. The Carnegie Corporation of New York launched a major study of teacher preparation. Both of these studies and others like them said, we have to fundamentally rethink teacher preparation. We have to pull content and methodology more closely together. We have to create a structure where students spend much more time in the field, but not just in the field, where they spend more time in schools, in primary schools or secondary schools, but where they do it under careful supervision with regular feedback so that they have the opportunity to grow intellectually and grow pedagogically at the same time. And many universities adopted such programs. I'll say the university I helped launch, the School of Education helped launch, certainly was an outcome of that program. And there was a lot of ferment in rethinking teacher preparation and putting theory and practice more closely together, in putting content and pedagogy more closely together. And I will certainly argue that those were essential steps in the development of a better kind of teacher preparation. And it's always struck me that it's one thing to read John Dewey or think about the theories of learning when you're sitting in a university classroom. It's a very different thing to read John Dewey or think about the theories of learning when you've spent the last 6 hours trying to make a class work with a group of unruly fourth graders or bored adolescents who really don't care much to learn all the exciting things you have to teach about American history. So I think that those kind of changes have dramatically upgraded teacher preparation on some campuses. Frankly, on other campuses, and sometimes down in another part of town in the same city, there was an assumption of, well, this too will pass, and we can keep doing business just as we are. And one of the things I will say that bothers me as at least some of the time, defender of university programs, is that we often all get lumped together. That the programs that have been completely restructured and the programs that haven't changed very much since the 1980s are described by New York Times writers like Bill Keeler as part of the same industry. Arthur Levine, who did a major study of teacher preparation just at the beginning of the new century, 21st century, estimated that about 25% of teacher preparation, university-based teacher preparation programs, had fundamentally redesigned themselves in the last decade, which leaves the sobering assumption that perhaps 75% haven't. So we've got something going on there. And in that context, more and more people inside and outside of universities said, I give up on the university. It's never going to change. It's never going to change fast enough. We have to find a different way of doing teacher preparation. And it's in that context that we get the alternative providers. So in 1990, a then Princeton senior, Wendy Cope, wrote her senior thesis suggesting a new organization called Teach for America. It's now a worldwide organization trying to recruit excellent people to the teaching profession. In the first years, Teach for America was very much structured on the assumption if we get great people and we give them a quick summer crash course in teaching, they'll be just fine as teachers for a couple of years. Teach for America, I think, has gotten much more sophisticated in its approach since then. There's much more mentoring, there's much more support, there's much more ongoing work, and in many places, the requirement that if somebody's staying in teaching more than 2 years, they will, in fact, have to earn a master's degree. That's a really nice model. What it means is that the master's degree becomes a reflection on practice, not something you do before practice. I worry, back to the old 1953 report by Arthur Bester, if we simply create five-year programs in place of three- or four-year programs, by adding more of the same, we never get where we need to go. If we think about restructuring so that you go out of the university and you're spending time in schools and you're having that experience, as a one-time fourth grade teacher in Harlem in New York, I still remember how scared I was every Monday morning. I think that experience has made me a better researcher and a better teacher preparation person. I think if you do that and then come back, you will understand educational theory, you'll read it in different ways. I told Edward yesterday my own experience of reading Paulo Freire for the first time when I was a student in graduate school, and I read Paulo Freire's The Pedagogy of the Oppressed. Some of you may have read it at times. And I thought, I don't understand what he's talking about. And then I left graduate school and spent a couple of years as a community organizer in Boston. And a friend of mine said, try reading this book. And all of a sudden, the same book was explaining everything I was trying to do and not doing very well. I think the same can be true of John Dewey, of educational theory. It's where we place it and place the conversations. So we've got, you know, the emergence of Teach for America. At the same time, educational authorities in the state of New Jersey said, we've had enough working with our education schools. We're going to create the New Jersey alternative route. Leaders in Boston created the Boston Teacher Residency. So there's been more and more growth of these alternative providers, and as the statistic I gave you indicates, they've been very, very popular in the United States. If you follow the money from the federal government, from state legislatures, from some of the nation's most prestigious foundations, the alternative routes to teaching, Teach for America, residency programs, Relay Graduate School of Education, are where the federal government and many state agencies are placing their bets. And there are times, this is frustrating when I get my proposals turned down, but I think it's an interest, it creates the interesting moment that we're in the middle of. So the question is, what do we do about all of this? Where do we go from here? The newly organized Council for the Accreditation of Educator Professionals, the new accrediting agency, has listed some criteria for excellence in teacher preparation that they say should apply, whether we're looking at a university program or an alternative provider. Last year, I had a wonderful opportunity to run a seminar with 9 graduate students who were looking at this topic, and they added their own 3 additional criteria. So now we're up to 8 criteria for what excellence in teacher preparation might look like. Again, I frame this. This is from a US context, and you take what is useful and ignore the rest. But I want to mention some, but not all, of those criteria, because I think they help us in thinking about what excellence looks like in teacher preparation. And from my own perspective, my concern is excellence in teacher preparation. I like getting a salary, but I don't care if it's done in a university or outside of a university. I care a lot that it's excellent and not mediocre. And I think if we can create an agreement that there are some accepted standards for what excellence looks like, we can begin to separate strong university programs from weak university programs, and separate strong alternative providers from weak alternative providers. So some of these criteria. The first is, obviously, content and pedagogical knowledge. I think there has been an unfortunate debate between those who argue that teachers primarily need to know content. If you're going to be a history teacher, you really need to know a lot of history. Or a science teacher, you need to know a lot of science. If teachers need to know a lot of content, and they can pick up on along the way somehow the teaching methods, or you know, some people are born with an aptness to teach and others aren't. I will argue that without question, a person entering teaching must have a high level of content knowledge. After all, as Edward knows, I wrote the legislation that in Massachusetts required a content major for every teacher back in the 1980s. Still want that on my gravestone. That teachers must have very solid content knowledge, whether they are planning to be an early childhood teacher, a primary teacher, a secondary teacher of English, history, mathematics, or one of the sciences. But they also need to spend time on what Lee Shulman calls pedagogical content knowledge, the transmission of how do we get young children who may or may not have any foundation, how do we get bored adolescents to engage in, to learn about our subject? And that's a different thing from knowing it well. It's easy for me at this point in my career to say, I know US history pretty well. That does not mean I can get a classroom full of middle school students excited about the study of US history. That's a different skill. And I think we have to be absolutely clear that before we license somebody to teach, they have both skills. Either one alone is unacceptable. Secondly, I think we need to build much more experiential opportunities into the teacher preparation programs at every level. At New York University, where I now teach, one of my assignments, I'm responsible for the introduction to education course, the first course people take in a teacher preparation program, which may be either at the sophomore level if they're doing it as an undergraduate, or the first semester of the master's degree. When I took over the course, I thought the basic curriculum was pretty sound, but it needed some work. We added some more materials to it, particularly on learning theory. But we also physically moved the courses from the university campus to New York City Public Schools and arranged, I still have budget fights about this, but we arranged to have them every discussion section co-taught by a university professor and a practicing New York City teacher. The fact that my students now sit in desks, sometimes desks that are too small for them, that they are in classrooms with a teacher who an hour before was teaching students, that they often get opportunities to observe those students or have those students come and talk in their classes. The fact that they use the same bathrooms as those students has fundamentally changed the way they discuss John Dewey because it's done in context. Later on, I've also become a very strong advocate for what are known in the United States as residency programs, the notion that before you become a teacher, you need to spend a full year in a public school or in a school setting, working with a teacher, perhaps being a kind of co-teacher in a classroom where you get to know the difficulty of teaching and the excitement of teaching, the incredible rewards when a student gets it, the incredible frustration when students are resisting for various reasons, and reflecting on what you did well, what you did poorly, but also seeing the school year for the whole year. In many university programs, every university program requires what's called student teaching, a period of practical experience in the school. I will argue that many times that period is too short. If you enter a school in our calendar in October and stay till December, you have missed that critical first week of school in late August or early September when the teacher does the kind of norm setting of a classroom. Anybody who's taught knows what that first week is like when you set the rules of the game for the year. And a student teacher who misses that week will spend the entire year wondering, how does that teacher manage the class when they all work together to create certain norms? The student who does student teaching in the spring and misses those weeks just before the winter holidays when kids are really much more focused on what they're going to get for Christmas than anything about that's going on in school does not understand how you have to pace the school year. So I believe both because of understanding the pace of the school year, but also because it's in those opportunities for practice, not just, okay, we'll create an apprentice program, but the opportunity for practice linked to reflection, linked to practice, linked to reflection, and seminars that take place in the afternoon or on Saturdays linked to that, where the methods courses are, again, reflection on what sometimes didn't work is much more effective than a notion that sometimes we have this sort of instructional timeline where we'll teach you everything you need to know, then you'll practice it for a little bit, then you'll be a licensed teacher, which simply doesn't work. Couple of other things that my students came up with that I also want to mention. One is any discussion of teacher preparation that does not include a discussion of the cost is simply unrealistic. And I think it's one of the issues we need to think about in terms of how, again, how you think about it in Catalonia. I am so envious in Finland that university and teacher preparation is free. It's not free in the United States. And I think it's one of the reasons that the alternative providers have been so successful. Teach for America is a free preparation program which you then are responsible for teaching for the next 2 years. And it's allowed them to attract really high-level people who don't want to give up salary for a long period of time and who are anxious to get on with their lives, but who also don't want to pay huge amounts of tuition. Some universities have been terrific at providing significant financial aid for future students. So Stanford University comes to mind. Stanford is one of the most expensive universities in the country. The president of Stanford said teacher education is really important and allocated $20 million to create a fund to support future teachers. So if you get into the teacher preparation program at Stanford, very selective program, if you get in, it's virtually free. To do the master's degree in teacher preparation because they have a range of financial aid that is incredibly supportive. Many other universities are very expensive. And this is not just private universities, although private universities are more expensive. So in many private university to do the master, if you come to do a master's degree in teacher preparation, it can cost as much as $60,000, that's about 52,000 euros, in tuition alone to go through the teacher preparation program. It's hard to ask somebody to pay that kind of money in a profession that still does not have either the financial rewards or the social status of many other professions. And even in many public, the best known public universities, maybe half of that. But public education in the United States is not free as it was when I went to school. And I think that's a serious problem that we have to wrestle with about teacher preparation. Another point I want to mention is that I think as we're rethinking teacher preparation, alternative or university-based, we need way more people in the conversation. In a recent paper, Kenneth Zeichner, a good friend of mine, professor at the University of Washington, argues that teacher education needs to make a fundamental shift in those whose knowledge and expertise counts and should count in new teacher preparation programs. And Zeichner argues that we need committees made up of university professors and practicing public school teachers and parents and leaders of community organizations and perhaps business leaders, none of whom have all the answers, but every one of whom has some of the answers. It's not to say that I as a professor come and say, well, I don't know anything, you tell me how it ought to be done, but it's that I come with my opinions and people who've been teaching that morning come with their opinions, and people from the community come with their opinions, and together, I think we're going to find new definitions of excellence that we haven't yet invented. The notion that the university is the repository of all knowledge, that because I have a PhD, I know and will instruct, and you don't know and will listen, is simply something that doesn't work in the modern era. And it shouldn't work in a democratic society. Lastly, one of the things my students talked about and that many people are talking about is that we need much more support and mentoring for novice teachers. The notion that however good a teacher preparation program is, at the time someone graduates, they are a finished teacher, is simply nonsense. I said finished, not finish. a finished teacher is simply nonsense. That learning is a continuum, and so many people, often independent organizations, have been creating mentoring and support programs for teachers in their first, second, and third year of teaching, creating the same kind of feedback and the same kind of ongoing conversation that needs to happen in the residency experience. And in fact, my colleague at the Woodrow Wilson Foundation, Audra Watson, argues that really when we talk about teacher mentoring, it ought to start the day somebody enters teacher preparation, not the day they graduate. We need to think about this as a continuum and break the split between university or alternative provider preparation and those first 3 to 5 years as a novice in the profession. So, I've told you a lot about our problems in my country. I think we also are on the edge of at least a dialogue that's going to be very productive and create some good solutions. If it is true, as Professor Levonin said, that education and health are the two key issues the society provides for its citizens, then the effective preparation of tomorrow's teachers is one of the most important social issues we face today. This conference and this enterprise in Catalonia is essential to the creating of what 21st century Catalonia or 21st century Europe or 21st century global economy and global society is going to be like. Without high quality and effective teachers in our classrooms, our teachers will not receive the education they need and deserve to succeed in the 21st century, both in an economy that is fast moving from an industrial economy to a knowledge-based economy, but also in the creation of democratic societies, the kind of societies all of us want to live in. And so it's the job of teacher licensure programs, of university-based alternative providers, to work together to find, I think, not one ideal program. I don't think we're going to find one ideal program, but to find very clear standards and multiple routes that are held to a standard of excellence and that will ensure that those entering the teaching profession have the fundamental knowledge, have the fundamental experience before they enter a classroom as teacher of record, and have the fundamental commitment to children to be effective in the kind of schools we need in the 21st century. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Jim. As you could see, Jim's thoughts are quite provoking and also quite close to our debate. So many of the things that he has explained are linked with our reality. There is just one thing that might differ, and I think that it doesn't that much, which is the economic one. When we discuss about this, we say, okay, we don't have the money to pay schools of teacher training like in Finland, or we don't want to go to this model where you have to pay a lot for a master's in education, but we do have capacity to train and to pay training of medical in medical school of future medicine professionals. So we could do exactly the same in if we do the selection, right? You have 1/3 of the current intake of teacher students, and you could have 3 times what you have now as investment for each one of them. So many of the things that we could imagine, including residency with stipend, it's possible even with the current budget. So based on that, please go ahead on thoughts, ideas, and continue the conversation. We still have 30 minutes for that. Qui vol començar? There is one, hi ha una paraula aquí.
Well, I have a question. I think it's a great idea to have this internship with a teaching practice, but do you get enough schools with good teaching practices so that student teacher learn, it's a not bad habit but good ones, and in the same level, let's say when I remember my kids going to school, the classes were very influenced by textbooks, and there's a big industry of textbooks, and very conservative. So. Is that a problem in terms of the new teachers learning not good habits, but bad habits?
The good habits, bad habits question, I think, is a critical one, because we're never going to find perfect classrooms with perfect teachers doing this. And it's part of the reason that I will argue so strongly for the residency year. If the novice teacher, the aspiring teacher, is in a residency and the teacher does some things that sort of make me or my colleagues wince because they don't think it's good practice, the very fact that you can do that as a aspiring teacher where you're still in the seminars and can discuss, gee, maybe that was not such a good idea, maybe when I teach I don't want to do it that way, is far more effective than what I see happen many times now, which is that a graduate of a program will go out and then be hired as the new teacher, and there's always the three cynics in the teacher's lounge who will say, forget everything they told you in the university, we're gonna tell you the real way. That forget everything you learned in the university, we'll teach you the real way is the guarantee of the problems that you're talking about. Whereas the notion that a teacher, an aspiring teacher, might be in the very same classroom, might see the very same mistakes, but have to then argue with their professor, either that the mistakes are a better way to do it, what we would call the mistakes are a better way to do it, or that maybe when they teach they don't want to do it, creates the kind of reflective practitioner, creates the kind of context for creating your own values and being able to be very clear about your own philosophical and pedagogical approach, which I think does not happen with an older system that I think too often we tried to get our students into perfect classrooms. And what we know about schooling, and you know, since you've taught or worked in Boston, you've seen the same thing, the first year teacher gets put in the worst and most difficult classroom. So if you've learned in only idealized kind of classrooms, you don't have the skill to go into other kinds of classrooms. So I think the dialogue is a way to respond to that. Now we have the problems with textbooks and outmoded instruction, and I can't wave a magic wand and fix all the things in education. I think if we can create a new generation of teachers, maybe even if they're stuck with some of the same textbooks, they will find ways to create a critical reading stance on the part of their students that will allow them to use those books with far less danger.
Més paraules? Un, dos, tres. Okay, then I'm following. Why don't you say something else about research and school? So one of the things that you mentioned yesterday was that you have this puzzle between universities that are research focused and that are asking their scholars to be ranked based on their scientific production, and at the same time, the paradox of schools of education that are pushed to do some kind of research that is not practically adaptable for schools or useful for schools.
I think that's certainly one of the major tensions that I experience in my own professional life, and I really want to have more dialogue with our colleagues from Finland and other places about the role of research in teacher preparation, within teacher preparation faculty, because on the one hand, of course we want the people who are teaching tomorrow's teachers to be research active faculty. I don't want to encourage, I don't want to for a moment seem to discourage the promotion of research active professionals being the leaders of the professional preparation. On the other hand, I worry a lot that I'm being very US specific here, in the move of teacher preparation into the universities in the 1950s and 60s, what happened for a generation of faculty members and their successors was a move into a university model where, frankly, we live in a world of publish or perish. Either you have a lot of publications, or you don't get promoted, or you may not be able to keep your job. And the result is, what I see around me is the production, frankly, of a lot of research articles that nobody ever reads, on the one hand, and on the other hand, a real pressure on faculty, particularly young faculty, to not spend very much time in schools, to spend less time with their aspiring teachers, because they can teach their class, but then they need to go back to their study and work on their research article. And I'm currently chairing the promotion and tenure committee for my program, and it's making me very nervous because I'm advising young assistant professors to do something that ethically I think is wrong in general, but ethically I think is the only way to advise them in terms of their own careers, which is don't spend too much time in schools, go off, make sure you spend time on your study, get that article published in a major journal, because you won't keep your job if you don't do it. And so I think I would love it if we could use the opportunity for this from this international conference to have more dialogue about how that is handled in other countries. It seems to me that we have this extraordinary opportunity to be research active, but to focus more of our research on very practical issues about what's going on in schools. My own students, I assign them one of my classes, I assign them to do a term paper, but they have to go to a school and ask teachers in that school, what research would be useful to you? And then produce a paper that's actually useful to that school. That's not the norm, and it's not what's acceptable often in faculty research. Or to refer to your earlier question, writing a textbook is not considered research. Well, we need better textbooks, so I want to change. I just wrote a textbook. Of course I want to change that rule. But I do want to change that rule because I think it's important that we get better materials into our schools. So I think it's not a matter of being, I wouldn't for a moment want to be seen as being opposed to research, but I think we need to rethink the kind of research and the role of research in teacher preparation faculty. There's a hand.
Hi, hi. 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 Comencem per aquesta que té el micro més a la vora i després anem allà.
Thank you. I'm curious about your opinion of this Teach for America and alternative institutions for teacher training compared to the traditional university from the point of view of you being a member of this. Okay.
I think that question is clear. So what's my opinion as a university faculty member of Teach for America and the alternative providers? I'm not going to criticize anybody until somebody's got a better model than I see anywhere at this point. I think we all have a lot to learn as we're moving forward. So I'm going to give you a kind of two-part answer. From my own perspective as a university-based faculty member, and this does, I get very worried, first of all, that I see in the United States this sort of standoff that many of the alternative providers, not just Teach for America, are really arguing about how bad universities are. And many in universities, many of my colleagues, are arguing constantly, writing articles about how bad Teach for America is and the other alternative providers. That shooting match is not productive to the kind of thinking we need to do. I don't think we have the kind of research that we need to actually make those distinctions, and I think way too much of the research that we do have is very biased by the outcome that the researcher wants to see. So a decade ago, I was writing a book about teacher preparation in the United States, and I wanted research on Teach for America and how it compared. And I found three studies that looked very carefully at the outcomes of graduates of Teach for America in schools and the outcomes of graduates of university-based teacher preparation programs. And one of those studies was very clear that the graduates of university-based programs were much better teachers than the graduates of Teach for America. The second study, funded by the US government, was very clear that the graduates of Teach for America were much better than the graduates of university programs. And the third study, which was the only one that actually had any credibility for me, said that they all did about the same in the teaching profession. So I always concluded that two of those three studies were wrong. I just needed to be sure which of the two were wrong. So what I really hope we can get is a very different kind of dialogue about what are the strengths and what are the weaknesses of different approaches, and how might we get to something better than any of them yet. So there's no question for me that Teach for America has dramatically raised the bar in terms of who enters the teaching profession. They are getting very able students from some of the best universities, the Yale statistic I gave. They are managing the cost of teacher preparation in ways that universities are not. As a university person, I do think that I want, in the long run, I want future teachers, if teaching is going to be a profession, people need to have a more solid theoretical base in learning theory, a more solid theoretical base in the purposes, the ethical purposes of education. Frankly, in my own field, in the history of education, how did schools get to be this way? But we could create many different roads to get there. So, and I've always thought, as a historian of education, what I really want to do is teach the history of education to people who've been teaching for 5 years, because they're the people who say, how in the world did we get this structure? Whereas novice teachers, aspiring teachers, really get kind of bored with the course. So I think we can learn from both, and both can contribute. In the long run, I want teachers who have some of the strengths of both. I want some of the excellence in recruitment, and I want some of the reflection on practice that a research and that universities can offer.
Yeah. Well, over here we are really feeling that some of the issues, or most of the issues you are dealing with, we are feeling very reflected in them, because we have the sort of same problems. And I just would like to point two of them. One is this idea that you produced 5 minutes ago of getting your research students going to schools, asking teachers what the problems are, and then producing a study on that and writing a paper on that, which sounds really nice. But my question is whether the the necessities of the teachers, the needs of the teachers, that needs the teachers make present are going to be those issues that in high quality journals are going to be considered as relevant to be published, so that these young researchers will get the conditions and the rewards that they need to carry on their research career. And connected with this, you've been discussing this sort of dual fight between what's more important, whether to be good at the content, to have a solid content preparation as a teacher, or good pedagogical preparation. And every time we have a school reform, which is every 5 minutes, we get this discussion on the papers all the time, letters to the editor, etc. And then you talked in favor of pedagogical content knowledge at some point that is needed to be there. In English, you don't have a word, or well, you have it, but you don't use it very much, which is the word we use in Europe and in Romance language, but also in German, which is didactis, which is this sort of pedagogical content knowledge you are talking about. And we have departments, university departments, that are specialized on this. But what we have is that we have solid, very serious, very reputed content departments, solid but not so that reputed educational departments, and then we have the at the very low, this is my perception, these people working in the didactica departments who, you know, they do things which is not as important as what the other people do. And that's a problem. I think that some people here will share with me. And it's a pity that you don't have this word didactica, because if it doesn't exist in English, it doesn't exist.
Maybe I'll take it home with me and find an English translation. I think you have raised two very important points. Thank you for that question. Let me start with the second and then come with the first, which is really the most profound part of this. I agree. Certainly in the United States and in every other country I have studied, there's this pendulum of education reform that shifts in various ways, but it never lasts long enough to actually try what we're doing. We shift, we're gonna shift to something else. And one thing on that pendulum is, well, teachers need more content knowledge. Oh, well, we really have enough content knowledge, teachers need more how to teach. And it shifts back and forth, rather than what seems so obvious to us is that teachers need both, and they need both in great depth. When Lee Shulman coined the term pedagogical content knowledge, which is very popular in the United States, he really meant teachers who had a very solid grounding in the academic disciplines, in the range of disciplines for primary teachers and in the discipline they teach for secondary teachers, and who had equal expertise in the ability to transmit that discipline, to get students engaged in the study of that discipline, to get students excited about that discipline at whatever level the students were with. I have been in meetings where I have heard people use it as one side of the pendulum, saying, oh, well, we don't need content, we just need pedagogical content knowledge. Well, there's no such that's a meaningless term, but it is part of this pendulum swing that you're talking about. And until we can get past that pendulum swing, I think we're going to have a very hard time achieving the level of excellence that we want. Then for the first part of your question, can the kind of research I'm talking about, where it's school-based, responding to the needs of teachers, get into the major academic journals? The answer is no. And I do it with undergraduate and early graduate students who don't have a lot to risk about that. I would be reluctant to tell an assistant professor who I'm mentoring that they ought to do the same thing. And that raises a much larger question. If we had another conference, I would like to pursue on what the future of the university is, because I worry about a structure of a university, of universities in general, which see the highest goal, this is an overstatement, but let me make it, see the highest goal of knowledge is to be utterly irrelevant to the practice of anything. And that's not, you know, this is not something that's been traditional in universities. University research has often been exceedingly relevant to the needs of society. I was at a conference a couple of years ago, and Governor Hunt, the former governor of North Carolina, who's widely respected as the education governor of the century, talked about when he was a child growing up on a farm in North Carolina, and the University of North Carolina invented a way to grow 2 ears of corn on the same corn stalk, and then sent agricultural agents out to work with farmers like his father to grow such corn. He said, "We never questioned the research value of the University of North Carolina. I don't know what the equivalent of 2 stalks on an ear of corn is in the 21st century, but if we want universities to have the kind of funding you're talking about, if we want them to have the kind of widespread social respect that they need to function at their level, we need to do a better job of making those kind of connections."
Una paraula, i aquí al mig hi ha una casa.
Yes, I was very interested in your comment that one of our challenges is to arrive at accepted standards of what excellence in teacher preparation actually looks like. And so I was wondering if you might address the difference in the direction that the USA, in all its diversity, seems to have taken in response to the poor PISA results in comparison with Finland. And mainly I'm referring to the direction of standardized teacher testing and accountability, the development of the core curriculum project. Whereas in Finland, as we saw this morning, where trust and professionalism and confidence has been developed in a context where there is no standardized testing, no curriculum, no accountability framework. Thank you.
You could also add the reflections on inequality.
Yes. You ask me a very challenging question, because I actually have been involved in these debates quite a bit in the United States, and I confess I have been one of the minority of education professors defending some of the high-stakes testing that goes on. So again, it's another conversation for maybe around the break and for more time. I will say this. I am very much impressed with the results in Finland of saying, we're going to really respect the profession of teaching and then trust teachers to carry out a lot of what they're doing. And it's probably easy for, you know, I've spent a total of 3 days in Finland, so I'm almost an expert. But it's very easy to romanticize what goes on in other countries. But again, we heard this morning, that's one of the sort of core values. The problem in the United States is that, frankly, I do not trust every teacher. And one of my good friends, Deborah Meyer, always argues with me. She says, Jim, you have to trust teachers to be doing a good job. And I say, you know, Deborah, I trust you, but I see some of the teachers when I spend a lot of time in schools in New York City, I see terrible pedagogical practices going on. I talk to some of the teachers who are now teaching my grandchildren, and it's not what I think needs to happen. I think Edward also just whispered to me, we have great pockets of poverty in our society, and we have a tendency of the way of financial systems work in the United States, that poor school districts often hire less trained teachers because they don't have the budgets. And so we have large areas where we really need to be thinking much more about some external mechanism where we're testing the outcomes. And at an ideological level, I do believe that the whole society has to be responsible for the quality of education, and we can't just say we're gonna trust the professionals to do it right and not worry about it very much. I don't wanna get to a system where teachers are reporting that 80% of the parents are leaning on them all the time. But as a parent and a grandparent, I was pretty involved in my children, now sometimes my grandchildren's education, to say, wait a minute. So there's a tension here that we need to work on. One of the issues, I think one of the most profound issues that we have to talk about is who are we, how are we recruiting future teachers and how are we honoring? So in a, how do we create a social structure that will respect teachers? How do we pay teachers at least an adequate salary? And how do we make it popular for excellent people? If we could admit 5 to 10% of applicants for education schools, I might want to rethink my answer. But we're not there yet, and we have a very long way to go. So we have too much testing in the United States. There's no question about that. But we need some level of testing. My colleague Pedro Noguera says, you know, do you want to eliminate the gap between white and people of color in education? Stop testing. You'll never know if you've got a gap. So we've got to pay more attention to this and how to do it right.
There's another word. I was going to add on this though that. That the trust to teachers in Finland is quite related with the selection.
Yes.
So you clearly select, you control the training, and then you give trust. But the two things should be together. I mean, what you are saying is you have no system of selection, you have no control of the training of teachers, and then what you have is a huge diversity, and this trust cannot be dealt with in the same way, right?
I think that's absolutely true. I think we also have a culture in some schools have a culture of high expectations for all students. And some school, and it sounds to me in Finland that even though schools are very independent, you've been able to create that culture in schools. Some schools in the United States have that culture. Some schools in the United States don't have that culture. And I think there has been some very unfortunate educational research that says, well, education can't over... I think it's now discredited, but it's still very popular, educational research that says education cannot overcome the problems of poverty. Well, as soon as you do that, you create a culture in the profession that we really can't make much difference, so it's not worth trying very hard. We've got to get over that before we can get... Ultimately, I want to get exactly where you're pointing. It's going to be a long way.
Sisplau.
Yes. Well, a short comment, because it's almost last time. Talking about again about research, my question or my opinion about this Shulman model that you mentioned that is very used in United States, I think maybe it's something lack to this model in a way, because we have the pedagogical content and the content the content knowledge. But where is the research in this model? I mean, I think the research is also important because the content model and the pedagogical model is every time it's more dynamic. So it's not something that when you finish the studies in the school, in the college, or in the alternative places, you will have a solid and stable content of research. So I think probably it's important also to have this idea of the research, not in the scientific research or the classical research, but more related with design research, reflexive research, and this kind of issues or this kind of perspective. Thank you.
Thank you. I think you and I are in agreement. I think for one thing, I mean, I hear at least two issues in what you also raised. One is when we're talking about the research that we want education professors to do, there are some major issues. How successful is a program that really has embraced a pedagogical content knowledge approach to teacher preparation? How successful is it going to be in relationship to other approaches, so that maybe we can get some better data that stops some of this pendulum swing between, you know, content over here and pedagogy over here. It's very critical that we not only get good research, but we get somewhat unbiased research about that. I tell my story of my three studies of Teach for America. All were done as research projects in universities. We need better research than that to begin to answer the kind of question you're asking. The other piece of what I hear in your question, maybe this just because I want to hear it, your question, but when we talk about pedagogical content knowledge, We've got to be asking also the question of which content, what kind of content, under what circumstances is that content being taught? So there's a major discourse. Some of us were having this conversation yesterday, particularly in the field of mathematics, but also in my old field of history and other fields. As much as I have pushed to get very solid training, preparation for future teachers in the arts and science disciplines, I sometimes worry about what's happening in those disciplines, as particularly in mathematics, as a mathematics major has become more and more complicated, more and more advanced theoretical mathematics, and less focused on the kind of questions that somebody like Deborah Ball is asking, who's asking about how do we help young children understand mathematics? What does it mean to multiply fractions? What's the purpose of ever figuring out multiplying fractions? Or understanding the kind of mistakes that young children make. People who do advanced mathematics research are not much interested in those questions. So I really want mathematical knowledge for the people who are teaching mathematics. But it's which kind of mathematical knowledge? It's the same in history. You know, what kind of ability to read a document and understand the historical context and the political agenda of the document writer? That's what I want history classes to teach, not memorizing a bunch of names and dates. So it's content is a code word for a whole lot of knowledge, and we need to figure out which knowledge within that.
We still have 5 minutes. Let me just finish asking you a last thing that you said yesterday. You mentioned it at the beginning of your talk. You said that the reform of that university teacher training is like the canary in the coal mine, right? Vosaltres no recordeu els miners que portaven un canari al davant i quan apareixia el gas es moria el canari i llavors no es morien els miners. I diu el Jim, la reforma de les facultats de formació de mestres és el canari a la mina de carbó. Because what you're saying is what we are facing now in schools of education is what the university itself is gonna face in 5-10 years, and you've already said 40% of teachers in the States are now coming from non-university training. Could you say a little bit more about that?
Sure. The nice thing about being outside of one's own country is you can be very provocative and then go home. The phrase actually was from my former dean, Mary Brabeck, who talks about teacher preparation being both the canary and the coal mine, the story of the coal miners who always took a canary with them. And if the canary died, they knew that the air was turning bad and they had to get out. And she says, teacher preparation and the critique of teacher preparation means that we are the canary in the coal mine of that the university is operating in. This canary has not died yet, but certainly we know that teacher preparation in the United States and in many places is under very severe critique. I do think that in the next decade or two, we are going to see the same kind of critique being applied to all of university teacher preparation. Margaret Spellings, who was the U.S. Secretary of Education under George W. Bush, launched a commission, it was called the Spellings Commission, to ask questions about the outcomes of a university education. How much are people really learning by spending 4 years in an undergraduate degree? And many people were sort of relieved when Spellings left office and Barack Obama was elected, but the questions asked by the Spellings Commission are not going away. My colleague Richard Arum has just written a book called Academia Adrift, and he talks about how little time students are spending in actual studies in the course of an undergraduate education today. So the question is bubbling around the edges of society. What's the value of a university education? How much are universities actually effectively teaching, how much are universities breaking out of a transmission mode to create people who really are embracing knowledge and embracing a kind of democratic citizenship, which ought to be some of the outcomes of a four-year undergraduate or a master's degree program. Those questions are floating around, and lots of people are asking them, and universities, I think, university presidents are well aware of this. The average faculty member at most universities, particularly research universities in the United States, is not aware of it and assumes this too will go away, which is exactly where it, you know, education professors were 30 years ago. So I think it's very important for us to think about that. Some years ago, and I think it was in the 1980s, Ted Sizer, a highly respected educator in the United States, wrote a book called Horace's Compromise. Horace was a high school teacher, and in this study of that Sizer, sort of the parable that Sizer told, Horace basically made an agreement with his students, which was they didn't have to learn very much if they wouldn't bother him, and he didn't have to teach very much as long as they'd sort of keep order in the classroom, because Horace didn't make enough money in school and he had a second job and he was very busy and didn't worry about it. Too often in universities today, it's not the same, but it's the compromise is, well, I'm not going to worry too much about my undergraduate students because I have my research to do and I have my other projects to do, I have my consulting to do, I have international conferences to go to. And the students assume that as long as the demands aren't too great on that they can go on with their social lives and have a good time. That's an overly stark portrait. It's not true across the board. But it's true enough that linked with rising costs, many people are starting to say, what are we doing here and what are we investing in? And I worry about that because I think it could create a fantastic dialogue about universities really rethinking their role. It also could create, what I'm seeing more often in the United States, is a major disinvestment in universities and giving up on the role of knowledge in a knowledge-based society. And so I think we in universities have got to take this seriously and get ahead of it before, frankly, people like the governor of Wisconsin, who just cut the budget of the University of Wisconsin by a quarter, get ahead of it by saying, well, universities are useless, so we're just not going to fund them. That's not the solution. But we in universities have got to be more convincing to the larger society that we have much more to contribute than we have been willing to talk about in the past.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.